If you decided to install and use Debian 9 stage, here is an overview of the Debian 9 installation process with some useful recommendations. Hello everyone, it's Linux User, helping you to install, configure and use Linux. These are the topics I'm going to cover in this video. If you're interested only in some of them, I suggest you use the timecodes in the description. The installation process of Debian is very straightforward if you're an experienced Linux user. But if you try to install Debian your first time, there are some things which I find confusing for new users. The first thing is the variety of installation images. On the Debian website, if you go to Get in Debian, you won't see one download link, as in many other Linux distributions. Debian provides a separate image for every case. First, you need to decide if you already want to install Debian, or you just want to try a live session without the installation. Debian Live Images provide an option to install Debian. However, I recommend you do the installation with the install image, not the live image. In the last Debian release, which is Debian 9 stage, many users had problems with installing Debian from the live ISO. Some of these problems have been fixed, but not all. Besides, live images have some limitations, listed here. So if you want to try Debian, use the Debian Live image. And if you decide to install it, go back, download the Debian install ISO, and do the installation using this image. Well, it is a little more complicated than it should be, but this approach is reliable. The installation images provide you two choices: a small network installation image and a complete installation image. If you have very good wired internet connection, go for the network installation image. Alternatively, download the complete image. On this page, you are provided only i386 and AMD64 architectures. These are the most commonly used installation images, and unless you have very old computer, 64-bit ISO is what you need. For all the other architectures, click on any of these links and find the architecture you need. If you have only Wi-Fi connection and you need a proprietary driver for your Wi-Fi card, you need to use Debian non-free images. Debian has strict policy against non-free software, so it's not easy to find links to these images on the Debian website. You need to Google Debian non-free images, and the first link will be what you need. If you need an install image, you go here. If you want to try a live session, download the non-free live image. Images with non-free software can also be helpful if your graphic card doesn't work well with free drivers. I don't need to install non-free drivers and I have good internet connection, so I will download a small net install image. Now I will quickly overview the installation process. If you want, you can skip it and jump directly to the post-installation settings. The timecodes are in the description. You need to write this image to a USB drive. I have shown how to make a bootable USB drive in my previous video, so I won't stop on this here. See the link in the description. Also, make sure that you have copied all the important data from your computer. The installation process will wipe all the information from your computer. I assume you have created a bootable USB drive and backed up all your data. You start your system, and at the beginning you go to the boot menu. I need to press F12 here. It can be any other key for you. Then you choose to load from a USB or CD. I press C here to boot from CD because I recorded in a virtual machine. You probably will need to boot from a USB. Now select graphical installer, choose the language you want to use during the installation process, I keep it English, select your location, this will be used to set your time, currency and other locale related stuff. I select Other, Europe, Sweden, but I will keep the language to English. I will speed up all the loading processes to save your time. Hostname is basically the name you want to give to your computer. I will keep it Debian. I think most of the users can skip the domain name. Here you can set a root password, but if you read this carefully, it says that you can leave it empty and your user account will have administrative privileges with the sudo command. I used to set sudo after the install, but thanks to your comments, now I know that it can be done automatically if you leave this root password empty. So you keep it empty here and set your password in the next step. Type your full name and your username. Now you set your user password, and this will also enable sudo. This is the most crucial part of the installation process. I will show you three scenarios here: automatic partitioning of a whole drive, installation without formatting your home partition. This is in case you had Linux installed on your system before. Manually partition your hard drive with reformatting of the whole drive. If you are an experienced user, use guided partition. It will partition your hard drive automatically. Let me remind you that this will remove all the data from your hard drive. So if you have not copied your data from this hard drive, stop here, cancel the installation, and do copy your data to another hard drive. If you are a little more experienced, you may go for manual partitioning. If you already have your hard drive partitioned with a separate home partition, and you want to keep all the data on that partition, this guide is for you. Let's say you want to use the partition number 1 as your system partition, and the partition 2 is your home partition, where you have the data you want to keep. Do the following. Select the partition 1. This partition will be formatted and used for the system install. Set file system you want to use. X64 is a good choice. Select to format it. For mounting point, select root. Optionally, you can label it as system. Add bootable flag, because it is your system partition and you will boot from it. Check if everything is as you want and select done. Next, select your home partition. This is the partition you do not want to format. Select the file system of this partition. You need to know the file system of this partition. Most likely it is X64. Do not select format, because remember, you want to keep the data on this partition. But I still recommend you to have a backup copy of this partition before you do all these steps, because in an unlikely but possible event, your data can be destroyed during the installation. Go to the mount point and assign it to home. You can see the summary of your settings here. The root partition will be formatted and bootable, whereas the data on home partition will be kept. If you also want to have a swap partition, assign its mounting point to swap. I prefer to use a swap file instead of a swap partition. See my video on how to enable a swap file on your system. Then check everything and select done. Make sure everything is fine. Press write changes to the disk. In the last scenario, I assume you want to erase the whole hard drive and create a new partition table manually. Select the hard drive you want to repartition. Confirm that you want to create a new partition. Then start creating new partitions. The first partition is usually used for the system. Give it minimum 20 gigs. Select beginning. You can label it as I showed in the previous case. Make it bootable. Then create a home partition. If you don't want to have more than 4 partitions on your system, keep it primary. If you need more partitions, select logical. For the mount point, select home. Optionally, you can name it with a label, then select done. As you can see, here's your root and home partitions, and they both will be formatted. Check everything and apply the changes. Here you are asked about a swap partition. I have mentioned already that I prefer to use a swap file instead of a swap partition. The link on how to enable a swap file on your system is in the description. If you prefer a swap partition, go back and edit. Next, confirm that you want to apply this new partition table. The system is installing. It takes a while. In this case, you have only one installation image, so keep no here. Here you need to set a mirror to download updates and install packages. Select your country. Select any mirror here, usually the top one works fine. If you use proxy, set it here. I will skip it. I suggest you to participate in the usage survey. It will help the Debian project. Select the desktop you want to install. By default, it will install GNOME. I prefer Debian XFCE, and I explained why in my video review of Debian 9 Stretch. I leave a link to it in the description. The rest you can keep it as it is. If you need to connect to your system remotely using Secure Shell, install SSH. If you are not going to use printers, you don't have to install print server. When you have selected or deselected the packages, press continue. This is the longest part of the installation, but I speed up it. When your desktop is installed, you also need to install a bootloader. The only scenario when you don't need a bootloader is if you already have another Linux system installed with a bootloader on your system. But this is not the case for the most of you, so select yes and install it in the same hard drive where you install the system. The installation is complete. Remove your installation media and press continue. If everything went fine, you should boot into a new system. This is the default look of Debian XFC desktop. Not very attractive, right? You can make it look much better if you follow the steps I showed in the video Make XFC Look Modern and Beautiful. Here are some tips I suggest to do after the installation of Debian 9 Stretch. Add contrib and non-free repositories. This will increase the amount of available software and enable you to install some not completely open source programs. You need to open your source list and add contrib and non-free to every repository. Ctrl+O to save and Ctrl+X to exit. Refresh the repositories. Now you can install some non-free packages. For example, MS fonts such as Arial and Times New Roman. Enable the latest security updates. If you are too concerned with security, you can add this security repository to receive the latest security updates as fast as possible. Receive the bug fixes as quick as possible. Fixes to the stable distribution often go through an extended testing period before they are accepted, and then these fixes are released as point release, for example Debian 9.1. But you can get all these updates as soon as they become available, and you don't need to wait for a point release. Just add this repository. After all the repositories have been added, update and upgrade your system. I copy all these repositories to the description, so you can copy-paste them to your system. Proprietary drivers. Unfortunately, I don't have a graphic card or a Wi-Fi card that require proprietary drivers, and I cannot demonstrate you how to install them. But I want to provide you links to the Debian wiki pages on how to install NVIDIA and AMD graphic card drivers, as well as Wi-Fi drivers. So it will be easier for you to find the instructions. You can also check the Linux channel Don't Call Me Lenny. He has a couple of recent videos where he installs drivers. If you can recommend any other channel or video with instructions on how to install non-free drivers on Debian, please leave a link in the comment section. I hope it was helpful. If you install XFC desktop, I suggest you also check my video 10 things to do after installing Debian XFCE. Also consider subscribing if you are not subscribed yet. I upload at least one new Linux tutorial every week. Thank you for watching!